invitation to give a series of lectures here. So you know me now, the face, at least the name is Pierre Labesse. So I am an old man, 70 years old, in Paris, I was born there. Now I am living in Marseille. More seriously, as academic career, I have been a student of Roger Cotton, and I have had the opportunity to meet Roger Cotton. Probably you know the name now. And I had the opportunity also to work with Langlands, which was a very important thing for me, of course. So let me describe the program of the lectures so that you can leave immediately if you think you know everything. So lecture one for today. I will recall standard things. So I will speak from so I have changed slightly the title of the lecture. This is not posted. Because I thought it was maybe important to give some background, because it was not clear to me what kind of background you have. So I wanted to discuss from the modular form to automorphic representation. So For the first lecture, maybe I have to apologize because probably a lot of the things I will explain are well known to you, but nevertheless, I think it's important that we have a common. If you cannot read, just ask, because sometimes I don't write very well. So feel free. And feel free to interrupt me any time. I mean, just ask questions and don't be afraid. I like to discuss things. So, okay. So, as a start, I will recall some historical things. So, lecture one. Already I will give the... Now you can forget about this and I start lecture. So, there will be also... I may keep this hidden. So the first, so it will be elliptic curves and modular forms. A lot of things with that. The second topic will be modular forms again for the analytic approach. And see, we'll discuss in slightly more detail crust forms, the notion of discrete spectrum, and so on, discrete and continuous spectrum. And if I have time, I will say things on interfering operators. And Eisenstein series. And last thing, if really I have time, is the general situation. Okay, so that's the program for today. So now, need some water or what? Okay, of course I just apologize not speaking in Russian. I'm sorry. I should have learned Russian before coming, but I didn't.
We didn't learn all of us French before we came.
Well, French is a language for literature, so for mathematics. One should use German. Okay, so we discussed the first topic, so elliptic curves. So probably and modular form. So probably all of you, I hope, know what are elliptic curves, at least If you don't know, it's not too bad. The limpid curve, so CP, will be C over some lattice L. And you have the Weierstrass function, which is roughly speaking the sum over 1 over z minus, or z plus or minus, doesn't matter, z plus omega to the square for omega in the lattice. This would be nice, except that this doesn't converge. So one takes 1 over omega, but then if we have a problem with the 0. And for us to add the zero term. Okay, so you will already immediately see one object one would like to consider, which is almost that. So in fact, one introduces more generally an object I call G, GK, which is the sum or omega in the lattice minus 0 of 1 over omega to the k. So please this converge for, of course this is the, I will assume the key k is given, and k greater than 3 in order to have convergence. For 2, it's almost convergent, but not. So, you can make a summation with some order, but it depends on the order of summation. So, at least, okay. So, we have that, and you know that one uses p prime derivatives. So, if one look at x equals k and y equals p prime, you have the well-known equation. You like me if I am wrong. So it must be y squared equals 4x plus 3 minus something which is denoted usually g2x minus g3. And the g2 is, if I remember, 60g4. That's the standard notation. And the G3 must be 140 G6. So that's the one of the objects that people have met in the middle of the 19th century, and immediately you see that the object like GK is a function of the lattice, it depends on the lattice, it's a function of lattice, and it has some homogeneity property. It means that Gk of say lambda L, where lambda is C cross, then of course obviously it's lambda minus Gk of L. Well, so, by definition, modular forms of weight k, it is understood, it's not said, it is understood that it is for GL2D, somehow, are precisely functions of the set of lattices so that there are a function with some homogeneity of weight k. But there are other properties that are very important. Other properties are that they are holomorphic with respect to the obvious structure you have on lattices. In fact, the lattices with respect to lattices. So the way it's usually I wanted to keep that, but maybe it's too. J invariant, the J of the lattice. So it's simply G. So usually it's written 1/7 to 8 G2 over delta. So this is weight zero. This is again holomorphic. Oh, but it has exponential growth. Infinity. I will explain what infinity means. But so it's not a Baudelaire form. Although it's very important in many things, for example for the theory of the of elliptic curves, of elliptic modules, this is an important object of course. And in the recent years it has been important in the study of the monster. And studied by workshops and people, and other people, but for us it's out of the game. So we shall consider such a thing. Okay, so that's just to give an idea of what's going on with the classical object. So now let me draw. Very classical picture again. So I said C minus R. It's better, in fact, to see it as P1 of C minus P1 of R. You had the point at infinity, which is in common. So now, on this object, you have the action. You know that GL2 acts on P1. In fact, GL2C acts on P1C with two orbits. With two orbits. One is precisely the P1 of R, and the other one is P1 of C minus P1 of R. This is an easy exercise. In fact, it's really important to understand the classical object to just see that the standard. So, at least it is important to observe that. Which one I take? I don't know. Yes. To make it pop. So, of course. The complex plane, this is R, you have the point high. So, in fact, if you write G times I there for G, A, B, C, D, well, G times I is nothing but A I plus B over C I plus B. And in fact, the stabilizer is interesting to say that the stabilizer of the point I in C is, well, Well, is it isomorphic to C cross? C cross viewed as the set of A minus B D A. So this is in fact the product of two objects that are important in the way one understands the general case. In fact, it's a very special case. You can view it as a product of SO2 times the real the set of positive real numbers. This is a polar decomposition. All this is very elementary. But you will see in general, if I want to write a general case, this will be denoted by K, and this will be denoted by A of G, or sometimes or A of G. So you can keep this in mind, because that kind of object will show up if you want to translate to the classical setting. So now, again, point I. Well, a picture that everybody knows, I guess. It gives you the fundamental domain. So this is D equals the fundamental domain. Or GL to D acting on Q1 of C minus Q1 of R. Which means that if you take the closure of D, so D is vaguely written. So this is this part depends on whether you put you have an open object, then the open object has no stabilizer, but if you take the closed object, the points here are equivalent, of course, with the action of GM to D, but doesn't matter too much. But so now it gives you a picture of what is infinity. Going to infinity is going to this direction. And another way to look at it is since the function, say, f is a modular form, then f of tau can certainly be written, since it is holomorphic and periodic, as an qn with a transitional q in c to the 2 pi I tau. And the Gross condition is to ask that the sum is for n only if the sum is for n greater than 0. Or if you prefer that an equals 0 for n. Okay, and there is a subspace of the form, which is that those the cusp forms.
Sir, what is it about an equals 0?
Gross condition.
Gross condition is that the sum runs for the n strictly positive, I mean. That you sum on n, or if you prefer.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. That's obvious. And cusp forms is that an
is 0 for n. So, which means that A0, the extra condition is that A0 is 0. That's the extra condition. So it's very, very mild as a condition. So I have kept things over here. And now, what I didn't say is that delta, for example, so the GK are the modular forms of K, but not Cuspidal. While delta is modular of weight 12 and is Cuspidal. And again, J is not modular, not a modular form. It's a modular function, but not a modular form. Only a so-called modular function. But again, this does not belong to the object we study. So I forgot to say something which is essentially obvious, but I forgot to say it. I mean, one passes from the I've been a bit vague on one thing. Careful. If you have, say, f a function of tau, and f tilde a function of lattices, so we say, so f of L, we say that f corresponds to f middle. When if f of tau is f middle of z plus tau z. So that's the correspondence between function of lattices and function of tau. And if you want to recover the homogeneity, the homogeneity property, translate, this is an easy exercise I let you do, is that f f of tau f of a tau plus b over c tau plus d equals c tau plus d to the k f of tau. So for a b c d in gn to z. So we change the basis by some element in gn to z, then the function f tilde is invariant. It's independent of the choice of the basis. The function of lattices is independent of the choice of the basis. Now if you choose a basis of your special form, you get a function f star. And if you express the fact that f tilde is independent of the choice of the basis, this gives you that. I let you do this exercise. So now you know, probably you already knew all these things. So, but I just want to introduce the language because it's important. So in this set, I can maybe now go to a more slightly more modern language. So, if you I will introduce groups very soon. So let L be the set of lattices. You can see. So obviously E, the set of elliptic curves. Then obviously you have E, which is isomorphic, or almost by definition, is this divided by the action of the multiplicative group of complex numbers acting by homogeneity on the lattices. So, okay, now L, well, it's I have written this as a set of bases divided by Gn Z. B, the set of bases of R bases. And C. If you take a basis up to an integral transformation, you get the lattice. So now the basis. Well, if you take implicitly here, I look at this with some base point. So the B is isomorphic to G and to R. So eventually you get that E. You get first that L is the same as Gn to Z, dividing Gn to R, and E is nothing but Gn to Z, dividing Gn to R, divided by C cross. Or if you prefer, I do prefer, I write this as so. In the classical language, this is gamma, this is G, and this is K cross what I call H. So the general picture, in fact, we are already in the general picture. Is as follows. Well, now G is a relative group. We have gamma, which is an arithmetic.
So G is a relative group
it's a relative group, and it's a set of points, set of real points, sorry. Say over Q, yes. Gamma is an arithmetic subgroup, otherwise, without that doesn't make sense. Of course, K is a maximal compact.
So, by definition, arithmetic means that the cohomology is finite, right?
To me, yes.
I mean, I'm sure that everybody knows.
Well, I will. This is just to give an hint to the general case. I will go back to more precisely in the analytic setting. I will be more precise. So, I just give you. So in some sense, here is G of R. Here, in G of Z or something in G of Z if it makes sense. But to make sense, you have to be able to define G over Z. So, in fact, well, I don't want to spend time on this, but so, already it makes sense. So K is a maximal compact, and AG is a is just a it's isomorphic to R star positive to some power.
So K is maybe a maximal connect.
Compact in G or in G.
K is maximal connected compact.
It's not
O of two, but. Because it's not of two, but just yes.
Wow. Okay. You have an infinite number of small things you have to be careful to, if you want maximal compact or in G zero in the connected component or whatever. If the group is not connected, or here the group is not connected, G2R is not connected. G2R is not connected. I'm sorry. So really it depends. You have a so it's roughly speaking. So I don't want to be too precise here. The notation will be extremely precise when we are at the index setting. But the classical theory. But just to say, it's roughly of the K cross H. So this is a space which is called sometimes X gamma. Or I prefer gamma under X, where X is this object and gamma is this. So that's in some sense the space we want to study. It's not exactly true, because what we have considered now, I mean the modular forms are not functions on this, they are sections of bundles. In fact, so I will certainly make a mistake, but not too much. A modular form is a function on G. But gamma, but not on G, but gamma, not K, with some homogeneity. With respect to K of AG. We have asked at the beginning that it transform under the power of k's power or minus k's power of the element in C cross. The C cross is that. So in fact, if you prefer, you have you have the set of lattices over E. And this is a fiber bundle, and you look at certain holomorphic section of the fiber bundle. So holomorphic modular form are just holomorphic section of this fiber bundle. Up to some power, some tensor as a tensor k or minus k. Let you decide whether it's plus k or minus k. So This can be seen as alignment over the set of elliptic curves, and this is a section of some tensor power. So now we have roughly speaking the picture for the general object. So the what will be automorphic forms. So I will remain. Until I am in the so general notion of automorphism. And homogeneity for modular forms. I will explain what it is. And gross condition. So the regularity property. Well, I will just say in a few words what they are. You ask that the regularity property there are two kinds. You ask that it is VG finite. What does it mean? You look at the enveloping, the center of the enveloping algebra of the real reductive group. And you ask that this is the forms are annihilated, they go to zero under some ideal of cofinite dimension in ZG. It's a bit technical, it means that the form has to be killed by many differential operators. Like holomorphy is asking that you have some elliptic operator that kills the form. So it's a fairly general statement. And you ask that it is also k-finite. Or if you prefer, you ask that it is vg-finite, which means that under the action of the center of the enveloping algebra, you generate a finite dimensional space. This is the same as asking if it is killed by an ideal of finite co-dimension.
So you get Z of G is
Z finite and K finite.
So Z of G is what?
Z of G is the center
of the inverse.
Dg equals the center of U of G, where G is G is the new algebra, U of G is the enveloping algebra, Z of G is the center of the enveloping algebra.
Okay. You go to the finance.
So you ask, it is ZG finance. So under the action of the, so first the function are smooth, you can differentiate them. And by the action of the differentiation, you get a space of finite dimension.
The image of the action of this is finite dimension.
Yes. And the same for K. You ask that
if the center of embedded algebra and you act on what one?
Well, you have obviously an action on this side. On the right. On gamma, well, in fact you can act on both sides since the center commutes.
Yes.
But the UG acts only on the right. The center acts on both sides, but doesn't matter. We are interested in general. We will look at the right regular action. This is where this is.
And then action on every function which is modular, it has to be finite, yes?
Yes.
Or the finite.
Absolutely. Generate a finite vector space. Because it's an algebra, so you have all the scalars, so you get the vector space. So this is the finiteness.
Well, and K finite again.
And K finite again by translation on the K. K acts on this side. You let you look at all the translate under K. This must be in a finite dimensional space. This must generate at most a finite dimensional space.
So the stabilizer in K should be.
Oh no, K is a compact subgroup. So you're not in the periodic situation. It's not an open compact subgroup and so on. No. Okay. So that's a classical object that has been defined by. Essentially, this goes back to Borel and Arishambard.
Yes, this is equivalent to the Gauss condition. Yes, which you
so the Gauss condition I didn't define.
It's homogeneous. It's homogeneous.
No, it's a different thing. The Gauss this translates holomorphy and homogeneity. This is the regularity. The Gauss condition is something completely different. It's not so easy to define. Well, I mean, you have to put some kind of norm of absolute value on G. It's called height, usually. Roughly speaking, it's something which is polynomial in the coefficients. And you ask that the Gauss is at most polynomial in the coefficients. So some kind of polynomial Gauss, exactly like in the modular case. You don't want to consider the J doesn't belong to this picture. So that's the stage before going to analytic setting. Okay. So now I will pass to the analytic setting. And what should I keep? I'm sorry. It's a bit long to raise all those things, but otherwise. So now I will try to explain. Oh, there is something I forgot to say. I forgot to say that x over gamma, or g, the x over gamma, is always finite volume. This is a theorem of Arishambard. It has to be very, so it's a play, it's because of that the AG is important. If you don't put the AG, it's not true. Because of that vector space, like object.
So, I forgot to say, essentially Harishchandra, but also Borel and Goldman and people like that. So the volume for the invariant measure of gamma under G under A of G is finite. But if you don't put A of G, it's wrong, because A of G is just the real line, positive part of the real line, or if you prefer, it's just by taking the logarithm, it's a vector space. So the invariant measure cannot be fine. Okay, so so now, the analytic picture. Well, there is already one comment I should make. I have always used GL2 instead of SL2, which is classical when speaking of modular forms. Up to now, it was not too important. If I had, chosen an orientation on the basis, I would have restricted to SL2Z and instead of GL2Z. So, apparently, it's almost the same. But you will immediately see that when you go to Hecke operators, this is immediately quite different. And the Hecke operators really belong to GL and not to SL. And in fact, I will explain probably in further lectures that SL2 is much more complicated than SL. SL2 is much more complicated than GL2, contrary to what people can be. The theory for GL2 is easy. It's common. SL2 is more complicated. So this is strange, but this is a fact. Okay. So before going to the analytic picture, I have to discuss a little what are the Hecke operators. For modular form. So I go back to Hecke. So in fact, what you want to look at is at the action. So you look at M2 of Z, and inside of that, you look at Tn, is a subset. Tn is a subset of integral matrices. With determinant. Gamma GL2Z. This is obviously a double class. Tn is a double class. The set of double classes in gamma double classes. So I mean gamma Tn equals Tn gamma equals Tn. If I take products here, we don't change the determinant. So it's a union of double classes. Okay, and I want to let Tn, so I consider F a modular form. Maybe I look at F2.
Maybe equals M to Z.
What?
Gamma Tn equals Tn gamma equals M to Z. The last point.
Equal. I don't understand.
You meant that Tn is supremacy.
No, you want it's not much.
Ah,
if I take the product. So it's a union of double concepts. Certainly. For obvious reasons. Okay. So if I look at F squared on a modular form in the sense of as a function on lattices. Then I can define also directly Tn
of F field of
Friedel.
Yeah.
What's important
is that true? So it's possible that the determinant of matrices is minus 1. It means that it's not Tn. Tn to Z2.
I don't understand. You have a matrix of determinant 1.
No.
Sorry.
You take G.
No, I am sorry. I am completely sorry. Of course. You're right. Okay. So plus or minus one. So
okay.
Sorry. Yes. Of course. So here you won't see a plus or minus. So what is that? It's the sum of f middle of L prime, where L prime is a sub lattice of L of index n. And just average over the neighbors. So that's a definition for this. It's a way to let Tn act. Okay. And so you have the point is that, well, I don't want to spend too much time on this. I will write. I want to introduce subject. Let me show up. Sorry. Formally, the object sigma tn over n to the S. So I don't want to make I could make the computation, but I give you the result because it's classical. So in fact, it can be written as I take my paper not to forget anything, Tp, so the product over prime p. Well, one observation is that Tn, Tm is Tmn if m and n are prime together. This is an easy result of the Chinese remainder theorem. So we take the p minus s plus p r of p, p minus 2s. So here r of p is just the multiplication by p. The lattice.
PP, so attach the matrix PP. Times gamma. So this is the action, this is R. This is this double class. Okay? So formally you have that. So this goes back to Hinkel. Well, you maybe I'll let you do that as an exercise. And the important thing is that when you apply an Hinkel operator, and if you assume that TP or TN is still this lambda n F rhythm with lambda n in C, I mean that F is an eigenform under Hinkel operators, then you immediately get that you can rewrite this as a series applied to F. So you get things involving the eigenvalues. But the important point is that if you know that the form, so I could give the proof, but I don't want here. So, spend too much time on this. So for M positive, I will restrict to cus form. So assume S is cus form. So assume you have that, then, and this is a cus form and this is an eigen form. Then what you get is that the AN is precisely equal to lambda N, A1, up to a scalar, which is a stupid thing which I always forget. I guess it's n to the 1 minus k, where k is the weight of the form. So that's it. So again, this is an exercise. I let you do, I can do it if you want, but it would take half an hour. It's pointless, it's classical. So what is the result of that? The result of that is that the modular form F, you can attach to it, to F quiddle, you can attach the series sigma of AN over N to the S. Well, you can also assume, to simplify up to a scalar, you can assume that A1 is 1. Then this has a product of 1 to 1 minus AP, P to the minus S, plus, so if you use the fact that there is the N minus K, so it changes a little the thing, so it gives you P to the K minus 1 minus 2S. You get a series of that form.
I check k minus 1 minus 2. That's it.
So you get that this series has a product, so-called an Euler product.
You don't assume at the moment that it is an eigen form.
I assume, of course. Of
you
course.
Assume?
Well, yes, F, TNF is lambda n F, for all n. And I think just form. Okay? Then, return 0. Yeah, I assume that will be that. No, otherwise, doesn't make sense. Then you get an Euler product.
And the above decomposition for the relation of TL. It's also assumed that it's eigen form.
For what?
For above.
You mean here? You mean that? This is formal.
half org, yeah?
This is formal. So, this has nothing to do with any F. It's a formal power series in double classes. Just formal. And you apply it, if you apply it to a function.